Well, good morning and welcome. We're so glad you're here. We're going to kick things off this morning with a hymn that I know is familiar to many of you. Are You Washed in the Blood? Would you stand and join with us as we sing?
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Do you rest each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a fountain flowing for the soul unclean. Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Excellent.
Amen. Amen. Good to see you this morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church. We're going to worship some more, and then we're going to continue our series on identity here in just a moment. Let me encourage you, if you gained any weight over Thanksgiving, I want to tell you about a new diet my mother-in-law put me on. You eat romaine lettuce with every meal. She calls it the E. coli diet. And so I've already lost 20 pounds since last week. So it's good to see all of you. We're going to have a good time. It's just us home folks here today, mostly. If you anybody from out of town visiting with us today, raise your hand up if you're in for the holidays. Just a few folks. Now, the rest of you, you're our home folks, and I want to let you know, you're my favorite. I don't know if I've told you that, but the others, I don't really care nothing about. But y'all are my favorite. I'm just so glad y'all are here, and it's going to be a good time. If you've been praying about membership, this is a good day. There's some folks that will say, man, I tell you what, I just don't want to walk in front of all those people. Well, about half of them aren't here today, so this will be a good time. A good time to join the church if God's leading you to do that. If you are visiting with us today, take one of those Connect cards from the seat pocket in front of you, fill it out, and then bring it to us at the welcome tent at the conclusion of our service. We have a gift for you, and we would very much like to give that to you before you go home today, all right? Roam around and greet each other in God's house this morning.
Creation cries to you, worshiping in spirit and in truth. Glory to the faithful one, Jesus Christ, God's Son. All creation gives you praise. You alone are truly great. You alone are God who reigns for eternity. And God is great, and His praise fills the earth, fills the heavens, and Your name will be praised through all the world. God is great, sing His praise, all the earth, all the heavens, 'cause we're living for the glory of Your name, the glory of Your name. All to You, O God, we bring. Jesus, teach us how to live. Let Your fire burn in us, that all may hear and all may see. God is great, and His praise fills the earth, fills the heavens, and Your name will be praised through all the world. God is great, sing His praise, all the earth, all the heavens, 'cause we're living for the glory of Your name, the glory of Your name. Holy is the Lord, the whole earth sings, yes.
Come on, sing it out.
Holy is the Lord, the whole earth sings, the whole earth sings. Holy is the Lord, the whole earth sings, the whole earth sings. God is great, and His praise fills the earth, fills the heavens, and Your name will be praised through all the world. God is great, sing His praise, all the earth, all the heavens, 'cause we're living for the glory of Your name, the glory of Your name. Love that came for us, humbled to a sinner's cross, You broke my shame and sinfulness, You rose again victorious. Faithfulness none can deny, through the storm and through the fire. There is truth that sets me free, Jesus Christ who lives in me. You are stronger, You are stronger. Sin is broken, You have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, You are Lord of all. no beginning and no end. You're my hope and my defense. You came to seek and save the lost. You paid it all upon the cross. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. I cling. Of its suffering I do drink. Of its work I do sing. On it my Savior, both bruised and crushed, showed that God is love. Just. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I am sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. Gift, undeserved life have I been given through Christ crucified. You called me out of death, you called me into life.
Yes,
I was under your wrath. Now through the cross I'm reconciled. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love. I am sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. In awe of the cross I must confess, wondrous your redeeming love, and how great is your faithfulness. In awe of the cross, I must confess. How wondrous your redeeming love, and how great is your faithfulness.
Praise the Lord, and you may be seated.
Genesis 29, if you have your copy of God's Word, go ahead and open it up there. Genesis, the 29th chapter, and I want to fill you in on a couple of things that happened over this past week that you'll want to rejoice with me in. Some of you knew, some of you may not have known that one of our guys, Paul Peters, had some symptoms and some things that really looked scary, and it was all signs pointing in one very bad direction. And he came back, he got his tests back, and he came back negative, and he was totally cancer-free. We heard about that this week. Also, Jennifer Skoll, if you remember, her husband came forward just a week or two ago, and we prayed for her with him here, and we asked God to do a healing work there. She had a tumor that they had found, and we're going to have to go in and do surgery and remove that. And when they went back to search for it again, it was not there. So really, really big praise there. God is a miracle-working God. He doesn't always, sometimes, you know what? If you're in Christ, one miracle you're always guaranteed is that ultimately you will be raised from the dead. So it doesn't always come this side of eternity, but every now and then he lets a little bit of that spill over, and for that we're very, very grateful. So Genesis 29 is where we're at. We're in a series we're calling Identity, and I'm as excited about this series as any passage, any series that I've ever preached in my life. I'm learning a great deal about myself and what God intends to do in me and through me as I study through this series, and I hope that you will as well. If you were not here last Sunday, I want to encourage you to go back and to listen to last Sunday's sermon. You can look that up on YouTube and listen to that, get kind of caught up. You don't have to have that in order to understand today. But we said last week that your identity is the core part of you. It's the hub and the wheel. It's that part of you from which everything else springs forth. It's your truest self. We said it's sort of like the sun in the midst of the solar system. It's the one thing, the object of greatest gravity that all other planets rotate around. We said it was sort of like a deck of cards. The deck may have very many different cards that make up who you are, and you may have different aspects of your identity. You have your occupation, you have your background, your ethnicity, your culture, all these different things. But then there's one card that rises to the top. It takes priority. And we said that if you're a Christian, that ought to be who you are in Christ. That should be the top card on the deck. The others may shuffle around, but Jesus should always come first. This week, we're talking about how God impacts and shapes, what His role is in shaping who we are. God's role in shaping our identity. Now, historically, there have been really two major camps. I'm going to show you a third today, but there are two major camps for how people have historically looked at identity. One is the traditional approach. The traditional approach believes in absolute moral values. It believes that they are outside of the person. It believes that they can be discovered. And it believes that the highest good was to honor sacrificing your interests for the good of your community, your tribe, your family, your clan, whatever it might be. So truth, absolute moral truth, is out there. It can be discovered. One ought to try to discover it. And the greatest good you can do is to give up your pleasures, things that you accomplish, things that you accumulate for the sake of your family. And it would say traditionally that if you are a man, that your greatest source of contribution would be to give your life in battle for your community, your nation. If you're a lady, historically, the historical cultures would say that one of the greatest thing, the traditional role of the woman would be childbearing, to build up the community, to build up the nation through childbearing. And then came the modern approach. The modern approach was different. The modern approach believes that morals are relative. It believes that one's own moral compass must be discovered from within. That good is not something that can be discovered, but rather something that can be created within oneself. Now, psychologists, when they're explaining these two camps, they talk about the decisive validator. And that is to say that if you're going to live by the traditional approach or the modern approach, that you have to figure out, who tells you if you're getting it right? Well, in the traditional approach, the decisive validator is the community or the family. They look at you and they say, good job, job well done. You're accomplishing your purpose. If it's the modern approach, the decisive validator is yourself. And you tell yourself whether or not you're getting it right and whether you're living a good life. Now, if you watch media, if you watch movies, if you listen to songs, you're going to hear these two approaches echoed in a lot of the things that you're seeing in the theater, especially today. Let me read you a song from a musical and see if you recognize which approach it's talking about. Now, keep in mind, it's traditional or modern, and see if you recognize which camp that this song is pointing to, and maybe you can identify the great work of theater that it was derived from. Here's what it says. The wind is howling like this swirling storm inside. Couldn't keep it in. Heaven knows I've tried. Don't let them in. Don't let them see the good girl you always have to be. Conceal, don't feel. Now, again, conceal, don't feel. Is what the traditional approach would say. Don't let them know. Well, now they know. It's funny how some distance makes everything seem small. And the fears that once controlled me now can't get to me at all. It's time to see what I can do. To test the limits and break through. Does anybody recognize it yet? The little girls get it. Yep. No right. No wrong, no rules for me. Well, why? Because she's the decisive validator. She's the one that sets what's right and wrong for herself. I'm free, she says. Let it go, let it go. Now you're getting it. I am one with the wind and sky. Really? Let it go, let it go. So the traditional approach would say, what would be best for my community, what would be best for my family. And by the way, the traditional approach isn't always the right approach. And I'm going to show you a third option in a moment. But that's when a person from a traditional culture graduates from school, high school, and they think about which college, if they're going to attend a college, they think about which college would be closest to my family and best for my family. And if someone from a modern identity approach graduates high school, they think, what would be best for me no matter where it is? You see the difference in the two? Well, the Scripture offers a third option, which is often the case in Scripture. We tend to approach things, you know, kind of with zeros and ones, kind of bilaterally. Like there's one way and a second way, but Scripture always gives us a third way. The third way, I would call the Christian view of identity or the gospel view of identity, and that is God is the source of truth. Truth must be discovered via a relationship with Christ, and God Himself is the ultimate decisive validator. So it's not culture, it's not self, but it's God. Now, where you see this most vividly is in the story of the prodigal son. The prodigal son, if you remember, there were two brothers. The younger brother had the modern approach to identity. He wanted to go see what life was all about for him and figure out his own meaning of things. The older brother took the traditional approach. He stayed at home. He did what was best for the family. But the father offered a third approach, and that of redemption and salvation, a third way to get to God by grace. Now, in our story today, we're seeing the formation of this patriarch named Jacob. He's been sent away from his family, we saw last week. His brother Esau was so offended with him that he only could console himself by thinking of ways he might murder his brother Jacob. And so his mom discovered the plot and warned him to flee, and his father told him, he said, you know, this would be a good time for you to go visit your grandpa. You need to go see Bethuel, and you need to see if there's someone of his kinsmen that you could bring home as a wife. And so he heads back to the land of Haran, and we pick up in verse 1 of chapter 29. We see here Jacob is arriving at Haran. He enters the city. He meets with a group of shepherds who have come down to water their sheep, and here's what he asked the shepherd. He said to them, "Do you know Laban, the son of Nahor?" And they said, "We know him." And he said to them, "Is it well with him?" And they said, "It is well. And see, Rachel, his daughter, is coming with the sheep." Now, Rachel, this is the sister of Laban. This is the daughter of Bethuel. And from everything that the text tells us about Rachel, she's a knockout. She's a beautiful young lady. And she's a shepherdess. So here she is. She's bringing a flock of sheep. She's coming up over the horizon. If this were a movie, you would hear the music kick in right about now. I asked my daughters and my wife, I said, now who should play, if we were making a movie, who should play Rachel? And they said it should be Gal Gadot, Wonder Woman. She's coming in, her hair is blowing in the wind, the music is softly playing in the background. Everything else goes out of focus, but it focuses directly in on Rachel. It says in verse 10, "Now as soon as Jacob saw Rachel, the daughter of Laban, his mother's brother, and the sheep of Laban, his mother's brother, Jacob came near and rolled the stone from the well's mouth and watered the flock of Laban, his mother's brother." Now that's kind of an odd verse. Here's what's going on. Generally, when all of the shepherds would gather, it would come a time where they all together could go and roll this massive stone, and it would let the water flow, and the flocks could be watered. But how many of you know that when a young man falls in love, when he really falls in love, really meets somebody who just captures his heart, captures his attention, it will bring stuff out of him that maybe he didn't even know was there? So he goes up and he rolls personally, showing his manhood. He rolls this stone away so that Rachel
could water the flock. Then in verse 11, Jacob kissed Rachel, and he wept aloud. Jacob told Rachel that he was her father's kinsman, that he was Rebekah's son, and she ran and told her father. As soon as Laban heard the news about Jacob, his sister's son, he ran to meet him and embraced him and kissed him and brought him into his house. Jacob told Laban all these things, and Laban said to him, "Surely you are bone, you are my bone and my flesh." And he stayed with him a month. Then Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be?" Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the older was Leah. Now notice that word, Leah. And the younger was Rachel. The story at this point begins to shift its focus from Jacob, then to Rachel, and now it's going to settle for the remainder of this chapter on the person of Leah. Leah, she was considered less than beautiful. Beauty is an odd thing, it's a strange thing, and it's different in every single culture. You know, there are cultures on our planet right now that go to great lengths to make their skin appear extra pale, because in their culture, a tan is a sign that you are a laborer in the field. And so people here, they will put themselves at risk of cancer in order to get a tan. Why? In our culture, it's considered beautiful. But in other cultures, pale skin is considered beautiful. So women will put things on their face to make their skin look very, very pale. In some cultures, historically, it was beautiful to be obese. If you read back, I did some digging here, and I didn't want to show, I had pictures, but I didn't want to show you the pictures. But there were pictures both of men and women that were considered the most beautiful among all their people. And they were very large. The idea was they were beautiful because they could afford to eat. They could afford food. And then you could read historical narratives that would compare them to the skinny people. This one lady was the favored lady in the harem, and she was quite large. And it said, you know, it drew comparisons between her and her skinny companions. And it really said, this is the beautiful one. Well, in our culture, if you're overweight, then it doesn't mean you can't afford to eat. It means you can't afford the gym, you know. So here, it's just such an odd dichotomy. In every culture, there are different standards of beauty. And when it comes to Leah, we don't know exactly why she wasn't considered beautiful, but in the eyes of Jacob and in the eyes of her family, she wasn't considered culturally attractive. In verse 17, it tells us a little bit why. It says, Leah's eyes were weak, but Rachel was beautiful in form and appearance. So these two things are drawn in comparison. Rachel, beautiful in form and appearance. Leah, with weak eyes, whatever that means. And no theologian seems to really know exactly what that means. Whatever it was, it didn't fit the cultural standards of beauty. Not only was this a problem for Leah, but it was a problem for Laban, her dad. Because in this traditional culture, the highest form of good is to sacrifice yourself for the sake of your family or your community. So for Leah, she would do that through bearing children. For Laban, he would do that by saving up, and probably at this point he had already been saving up for a large dowry so that he could make her more appealing in the eyes of young men. Now, Jacob wasn't interested in Leah at all. He's interested in her sister Rachel. It says in verse 18, Jacob loved Rachel. And he says to Laban, "I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter Rachel." Laban said, "It is better that I give her to you than that I should give her to any other man. Stay with me." So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, but they seemed like a few days because of the love he had for her. So that was the arrangement. That was the deal. He would serve. He would be a laborer in the household of Laban for 7 years. And at the conclusion of that 7 years, the two would be married. Now, in this culture, in this day and time, when it finally, the 7 years were complete, and it was time for Rachel and Jacob to be married, they would have had a great feast that would have lasted about a week, 7 days. And at the end of that feast, the two would go in, the husband and the wife, the bride and the groom, would go into a tent, and they would consummate the marriage. So, supposedly, that's what happens. It's late at night. Perhaps Jacob had had too much to drink. We don't know really what's going on, but for some reason, he didn't know who he went in that tent with. And he wakes up the next day, and I love, verse 25 is one of the funniest verses in the Bible, in my opinion. Verse 25 says, "And in the morning, behold, it was Leah." Now, I just imagine Fred Sanford waking up by Aunt Esther right there. You know, "Behold, it was Leah." Now, bless Leah's heart. Can you imagine how she felt when he stormed out of that tent and asked Laban, "What on earth have you done?" I heard a story a few years ago about a gentleman who was traveling out west, and he was in Vegas, and he was staying in a hotel, and very wealthy man. And he goes downstairs one night, and he hears this lady singing in the lounge. And it's just the most beautiful voice he's ever heard in all of his life. And when the show was over, he approached the singer, and he said, "Ma'am, oh my, what a voice, what a voice. Ma'am, can I please have your hand in marriage? I have plenty of money, and I can make you a very rich woman. And we're in Vegas. You only live once. Why won't you give me your hand in marriage?" And so she agreed. And they went that night to a little chapel there in Vegas, and they got married. And when they got back to the room, she took off her wig. She pulled out her teeth. She took out her glass eye. She washed off all of that makeup. He looked at her and he said, "Sing, woman, sing." Julie told me not to tell that, but I thought it was funny. So anyway, "Behold, it was Leah. And Jacob said to Laban, 'What is this you have done to me? Did I not serve you for Rachel? Didn't you read where I said Rachel? Not Leah, Rachel. Why then have you deceived me?'" Now, isn't that ironic? You know what Jacob was known for. Why is he here in the first place? Because of deception. His poor blind father he deceived by dressing up like his brother. But he now is reaping exactly what he has sown. Well, Laban has a story ready. He says in verse 26, "It's not done so in our country to give the younger before the firstborn. Complete the week for this one, and I will give you the other also in return for serving me another 7 years." Here's what he's saying. He's saying, "Okay, look, you need to be married to her for this week, but after that, I'm going to let you go ahead and marry Rachel too, but then you give me another 7 years. But rather than you having to pay up front and wait 7 years, I'm going to go ahead and give you Rachel." So in the course of a week, he has two wives. Jacob did so. He completed her week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel to be his wife. Verse 29, Laban gave his servant Bilhah to his daughter Rachel to be her servant. Verse 30, "So Jacob went into Rachel also, and he loved Rachel more than Leah, and he served Laban for another 7 years." Now, you'll see the idea of love and hate coming up all through this portion of Genesis. Remember that we said earlier that love means favor in this context, and hate just means kind of disinterest or lack of favor. So, "Jacob, I have loved. Esau, I have hated." He's just saying, "I have favored Jacob over Esau." And so here when it says he loved Rachel more than Leah, he's saying he really gave his attention, his favor, his priority to Leah. I'm sorry, to Rachel. And Leah was just kind of there. It says in verse 31, "When the Lord saw that Leah was hated..." That doesn't mean she was despised in the way we mean the word hate, but it means that she just wasn't prioritized. Last part of verse 31, "He opened her womb, but Rachel was barren. Now, in this culture, again, a lady is expected to bear children. Children would be both the retirement plan and Social Security. Children were your everything. If you didn't have kids, you really didn't have hope in this culture. Verse 32, Leah conceived and bore a son, and she called his name Reuben, for she said, "Because the Lord has looked upon my affliction, for now my husband will love me." Reuben means I am seen. There was something in the heart of Leah, and here's what I want you to do. I want you to really understand how it must feel to be Leah. She's looked down upon. She's not prioritized. She's not favored. And God looks at her and has mercy and gives her a child. And she says, now that I have a child, now I will be seen. She felt invisible. But now I will be seen. Verse 33, she conceived again and bore a son. And said, "Because the Lord has heard that I am hated, he has given me this son also." And she called his name Simeon. Simeon means I am heard. So Reuben means I am seen, because she probably felt invisible. And now she names her kid I am heard, because she probably felt like no one listened. Then verse 34, again she conceived and bore a son and said, "Now, this time, my husband will be attached to me because I've borne him three sons." Therefore, she called his name Levi, which means attached. She felt unattached. She felt as if she weren't married at all. They were obviously intimate. You see here they've had three sons. But there was no soul intimacy. There was no connection. She felt disconnected. She felt unheard. She felt like she was invisible. And with every child, which in her day, the child was supposed to be the answer. It was what you were expected to do. With every child, she thought, now this time, everything will be okay. But then in verse 35, she conceived again and bore a son. And she said, now this time, I will praise the Lord. Therefore, she called his name Judah, because she ceased bearing. Something about that fourth child, it made her realize that this would not fill the deepest need of her heart. This would not make all of her dreams come true. Something about that fourth child said, something I'm longing for can't be found in a baby. Something, there's a need in the recesses of my heart that no other human being can meet. So I'm going to have to look elsewhere. And she turns her attention from what had become an idol of her children to God and Him alone. And says, now I will praise the Lord. And by the way, she uses a name for the Lord there. It's very interesting. You see, everywhere else in the Old Testament, the name Elohim was used. Elohim was just sort of the catch-all name for God. So whether you were a Jewish follower of God, or whether you were one of the pagans, when you referred to God, you called him Elohim. It was just the name for the Most High God. But here, she uses the name Yahweh. Yahweh was the name that God gave Abraham when he said, let me tell you who I am. When they made a covenant, I am Yahweh. This is the covenant name of God. And he introduces himself here to her as her Yahweh. Well, Leah came to the place in life where God became more than a concept, Elohim. He became a friend, Yahweh. Now, what does this story tell us? In the formation of Leah's identity, and what does this story tell us about the formation of ours? Number one, God works in shaping your identity. God works through difficult circumstances. For Leah, it was her looks. She did not and could not, no matter how hard she tried, meet the cultural standards of beauty. What is it in your life that you consider less than optimal? By the way, did you know studies have been done and there's literally nobody who thinks they look just perfect? You know, I know there's a couple of guys that I've met that when they look in the mirror every morning, they sing "How Great Thou Art," you know, but most people, their feet's too big or their ears are too small or, you know, one arm's longer than the other. There's always something that they find that they despise about themselves. And for you, it may not be your looks. It may be your IQ. Just not quite as intelligent as the others around you. It may be your talent. It may be your occupation. It may be your income. But something about you that if you could change it, you would, but you can't. It is what it is. Well, God works through those things. As a matter of fact, God is attracted. The more difficult your circumstance, now get this, because the whole world is telling you something different. But the more difficult your circumstance, the more God is drawn to you. God is drawn to people who have been humbled by the realities of life. And if that's you, good news, my friend. That's like a sweet perfume in the nostrils of God. As a matter of fact, if there's somebody here this morning who has it all together, and man, they just look like a glossy 8x10. You know what I'm saying? I mean, they just walk around looking beautiful all the time, and they're smart, and everything's going right for them. And when I talked about problems, nothing came into their mind. Then we ought to give an invitation just for that person. We ought to bring them down here to the altar and lay hands on them. And we ought to pray that God would bring some difficulties into their life, because you see, it's almost impossible. When everything is perfect, it's almost impossible to get close to God. That's why Jesus said, "Woe to those who are rich, because it's easier for a camel to get through an eye of a needle than for a rich man to get into heaven." That's why sometimes it can be a curse if everything... And by the way, I've never met anybody. I've never met a soul in all my 42 years, I've never met a soul that didn't have something that devastated them in their life. When somebody... It always tickles me when somebody comes up to me and says, "Pastor," they kind of pull me over to the side. "Now, I don't want anybody to know this, but I need you to pray for me because my marriage isn't perfect. Or my children aren't perfect. Or I may not have my job next week." And I think, why is this such a secret? Because if you knew what was going on in his life and her life and that one's life, and if you knew how they brought me aside last week to tell me something to pray for them about, nothing, you wouldn't be ashamed. You wouldn't be disappointed. You wouldn't be crushed. You just realize that humans are broken. And God loves them that are broken and that will own it and don't try to cover it up. One of my favorite verses in the scripture is when doubting Thomas sees Jesus after the resurrection. Do you remember what Thomas said? "I'm not going to believe until I see some scars." We always judge him. But Jesus, in the resurrection, had no plastic surgery. He said, "Here are my scars. And if you'd like, you can feel the hole in my side. Because I've been devastated by the cross, and I've got scars to prove it. So if you have some scars in your life, if you've been through some stuff, if you, like Leah, look at yourself in the mirror and say, 'I don't always love what I see there.' If you will admit it and own it, good news. God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to who? The humble. God doesn't want to humiliate you, but he does want you humble before him. And if your heart will take that position, that heart attitude of humility, and just say, 'God, here's who I am,' and nothing surprises you." I remember a pastor saying one time, "Has it ever occurred to you that nothing's ever occurred to God?" God, I'm going to tell you something, and I know this may surprise you, but I sinned yesterday. God says, you sinned in ways you don't even know of, and it doesn't surprise me. And I knew it when I died on the cross for you. Just be who you are before God and walk. And God is using those things. The furnace of affliction, he uses sometimes to shape you and shape your identity. Some of you have gone through, some of you are just on the back end of a great trial, and you've come through it and you've survived it, but there's scars. Make those scars trophies of grace. And realize that they're making you who you are. A senior adult lady came up to her pastor one day, and she had been broken and bent over because of arthritis and all of these different ailments in her body. And she said, Pastor, why has God made me this way? And the wise pastor said, Sister, he's not made you, he's making you. He's using this in your life to form you into a person. And here's the thing. The reason I like the analogy of a deck of cards, God doesn't want uniform robots making up his people. He wants every one of you to, in your own way, in your own peculiar, particular way, with your own gifts and your own experience and your own life journey, to reflect who he is to the world. And he wants you to be unique. He wants you to be different. There aren't tailor-made trials. They're customized. They're not trials that everybody goes through in the same way. You go through it in a very unique way, because he's making you someone that only you can be. God works through difficult circumstances. And then secondly, God shows the impotence of idols, the powerlessness of idols. With every one of these children, Leah said to herself, well, maybe now things will get better. An idol is a card in the deck that has undue prominence. If you take a card that should be halfway down the deck and move it to the top card, it becomes an idol. There are things in your life that God says, I very much want them to be there. I just don't want them to have the priority and the prominence. They're good. They make you who you are. They should be there. But you've moved it up way too high in the list. And for Leah, with every child, she put her hope in this child. Now I will be seen. Now I will be heard. Now I will be attached, until number four, Judah. And she says, now I'm going to put my hope in God. There's something about idols that we're tempted to lean upon like a crutch. We're tempted to run to them, to put our hope into them. So, you know, use your imagination. For you, it could be a job. It could be a relationship. If only, if I get my license, for me at one time, a license was an idol. Oh, if I get my license, everything will be okay. If I graduate high school, everything will be fine. Once I get out of college, then if I could only get married, then if I only had a child, if I only had my master's degree, if I only had a church at the beach. And all of those things are good, but none of them are God. And none of them can meet the deepest needs of my heart, and they can't meet the deepest needs of your heart. And they're not supposed to. John Maxwell told the story one time of being in a conference, and somebody, he and his wife, Margaret, were both answering questions from the audience, and somebody raised their hand, and they said, I have a question for Margaret. He said, okay, go ahead and ask her your question. She said, does he meet your needs as a husband? And Margaret thought for a second, and she said, and John said, he was over there thinking, oh, go ahead and tell him what a great husband I am. And said, Margaret finally looked up and said, no, he doesn't at all. And he said, well, please explain. She said, well, the first couple of years, I tried to have all my needs met by John, but then I realized that that wasn't his place, that only God could really fill the deepest needs of my heart, and John couldn't do that. And when I finally started finding my fulfillment in God, then her husband became a great part of her life and a huge blessing, But if you put a good thing where only God is supposed to be, you will at first idolize them, and then you will curse them. Now, please get that. If you take a good thing that God has given you and you put it where only God is supposed to be, inevitably, when it lets you down, you'll curse it. And that may be a marriage, it may be a child, it may be a job, it could be 1,001 things. Good things placed where only God is supposed to be. Derek Kidner wrote in his commentary, "The story of Jacob marrying Rachel and waking up next to Leah is a miniature of every disappointment from Eden onward. No matter what you have hopes in, what you put your hope in the morning, it will always be Leah." What does that mean? That means whatever you're looking at as your one thing, if I only could have this, when you get it, in the morning, you'll wake up disappointed. I'm very careful because I know we're going to Israel this week, and I know a lot of you are very excited that are going, and you should be. It's going to be a great trip. But if you look at it and you think, once I go to Israel, then I'm going to really be a great Christian. No, you won't. No, you won't. And I've been very careful to say, God is just as much here as He is there, haven't I? Over and over, I've tried to remind you of that. Oh, if I could only meet this person, then everything would come together for me. No, it won't. You'll wake up the next morning, and that dream will be like a Leah. You will be disappointed because it cannot give you what you thought it could give you. Now, what is that in your life? And God is showing, if you find yourself disappointed in something today, maybe God is in that showing you the impotence of idols. In the last story, in the last chapter of John, there's a story that most people overlook. It's one of my favorite stories. It's a conversation that Jesus is having with Simon Peter. It's right after Jesus asked him 3 times, "Peter, do you love me? And if you do, feed my sheep." And they have that whole conversation. Well, most of the time we sign out. The sermon ends right there. But the most interesting portion to me is what's next. Jesus looks at Peter and he says, "Truly, I say to you, when you were young, you used to dress yourself and walk wherever you wanted, but when you're old, you will stretch your hands out, and another will dress you and follow you and carry you where you don't want to go." Here's what he's saying. Peter, you've been young, strong, impetuous, but there's coming a day when you're going to be absolutely dependent on those around you. Some of you are nearing that time. You're finding you need other people more than you ever have. And Jesus looks him square in the eye and he says, "Follow me. In that season of life, follow me. Focus on me and realize it wasn't your strength, it wasn't your quick wit, it wasn't your boldness. None of that stuff is what drew me to you. What draws me to you is your need. So in that season of your life, of all times, follow me." Peter did what so many of us do. He began to kind of scan the room. He looks around and he finds John. John was the beloved. He was the one that was always closest to Jesus. And he says, "Well, what about him? Is he going to have to go to the nursing home? Is he going to get rheumatism? Is he going to have Alzheimer's?" And Jesus, in so many words, looked at him and said, "Peter, don't worry about him. You follow me." What a good word. Because you see, at the end of the day, we're all Leah. We look at it, we want to relate to young Jacob and Rachel, but in the whole story of things, Jesus is the Jacob. He's the groom who's looking for a bride. And we are the one who, despite everything we've tried, all the different hopes and wishes and dreams, we feel unattached, unseen, and unheard. All of those things the world told us would make us seen and heard and attached, they all left us empty. And God says, now that you've given up on all of that, you follow me. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. As our musicians come and get ready for the invitation, let me ask you, what is it that God is telling you to lay down this morning? I think it's Jeremiah who talked about broken cisterns. Cisterns that just won't hold water. Now, that's what the promises of this world are very often. They're broken cisterns. And they just don't do what they promise. They're idols. So now, some of these things, they need to be in the deck. They just don't need to be the top card. What is it that God is asking you to reprioritize this morning? What is it that He's saying, you follow me. Put me at the top of your deck and don't let him have the priority. Don't let her have the priority. Don't let that have the priority. It's going to let you down. It's going to disappoint you. Let me be the priority. You follow me. Just take a moment and do some heart reflection, meditation, search. You can do what God's calling you to do. For some of you this morning, for the very first time, Christ has not been in your deck. He's not been a true part of your life. You've been like Leah, calling him Elohim. He's been a generic concept, but now he needs to become a friend. He needs to become your Yahweh. If you remember last week, we saw when Jacob met God, there was a ladder between him and God. In the New Testament, Jesus said, I'm the ladder. I'm not a step in the process. I'm it. Come to me and you have God. If you're here this morning and you're not sure where you stand with God and you want to settle it, hey, as I told you earlier, it's not a better time than today. You've got some anonymity today. You've got some space today. You don't have to go by so many people. It's a holiday. Maybe you're here on travel and God's brought you here for such a time as this. You come. I'm going to pray a short prayer. When I say amen, that's your invitation to step out and come. Others of you, you've been praying about membership and God is confirming it. That you need to be in a place that's going to remind you that the things of this world never have and never will bring ultimate fulfillment. It's only in your walk with God. We're going to pray a short prayer, and when we say amen in just a moment, I want to invite you to step out and come. Father, Lord, we ask you today to take that priority, to take your seat upon the throne of our heart. May all other idols move aside. And may you rule and reign as only you can. And God, these other things, may we see that they're important, they're precious in our life, but they're not the priority. And may we, like Peter, say no matter what happens, we'll follow you. This we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. You come if God is drawing.
Gently
lost for words, so lost in love I am. Sweetly broken, wholly surrendered. Priceless gift, undeserved life.
Who else? Is God speaking to you? You come.
Through Christ crucified, you called me out of death. Yes. You called me into life. I'm reconciled. At the cross you beckon me, draw me gently to my knees, and I am lost for words, so lost in love I am. Sweetly broken, wholly surrendered.
The words of that song are so true. As our ushers make their way forward, I was thinking about last week at our Thanksgiving Low Country Boils, we celebrated communion, and I was reading where it said, Jesus took the bread, he broke it, and he blessed it. And it occurred to me, I almost preached a sermon right there in the middle of it. I mean, it occurred to me that how often Jesus does, before he blesses us, he breaks us. Showing us that we can't depend on ourselves, we can't stand on ourselves, we can't rely on ourselves. And then when we realize that, sweetly broken, wholly surrendered, then we're in a place that he can bless us as only he can do. Well, as we come to this time in our service, we're going to worship through giving. I want to encourage you, if you are not a member of our church, we don't ask you to give a dime, but if you are, we encourage you to be faithful. And let's see how God, we can end this year so strong. Ready to go to new levels in 2019, all right? Let's go to him in prayer. Father, we come back to you, Lord, again, bringing our tithes, our offerings back to you, asking you to receive it, to bless it, and to use it for the furthering of your kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please be seated.
Good morning, church, and thanks for joining us for service this morning. Hopefully you had a great time. How's that tryptophan kicking in? Are you still eating those turkey leftovers? We hope that you had a great Thanksgiving, and we thank you for making us a part of your Thanksgiving weekend. There's a lot of stuff coming on as we gear up for Christmas time, so check it out. Here's what you need to know. Beginning December 2nd and going through the 9th, we ask everyone to join us in the Lottie Moon Week of Prayer for International Missions. Prayer guides are available in the foyer. Also, we have begun our Lottie Moon Christmas offering campaign. Our goal this year is to raise $15,000. There are giving envelopes available in the foyer, or you may give online and designate the gift is for Lottie Moon. This is a great cause and a great way to be effective around the world. On Sunday at 6:30 p.m., that's December 9th, we will have our annual Christmas program, and this year it's called O Come, Let Us Adore Him. This is also our Toy for Tots program for the year, and this will be an evening filled with songs celebrating the birth of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. We are collecting toys for the local Toys for Tots, so the admission to the Christmas program is one new unwrapped toy. That's December 9th at 6:30. We'll see you there. Are you a parent of a teenager? We've got something just for you. Parent Night Live on December 10th at 6:30 p.m. in the youth room. Parents, we're going to have a night just for you. It's going to be a great time of fun and worship and interaction. Come and hear about the vision for 2019. And by the way, parents, it's just for you. So leave the teenagers at home. If you have a younger child that you can't leave with your teen, go ahead and bring them on out. We'll have childcare for them. It's going to be great. It's going to be fun. Can't wait to see you there. Well, hey, church, like I said, there's a lot of stuff going on, and the Christmas season is such a special time for us to come together, for us to serve together as a church family. So find out what's going on, get involved, and make a difference. Thanks, and have a great week.
One of these weeks, I'm just going to wear the same shirt. Then I just hop out of the screen and just come on down here. Hey, it has been a wonderful service here, and we do really thank you for being here with us. We know holiday weekends can get busy, can get crazy, and so thank you for taking time to be here and worshiping with us. If you're visiting the area and you chose to come and find a church, because that's what my family does when we're out of town, we go find a church to hang out. We're so glad that you were here. Make sure you do stop off and say hi to Pastor Zach and Julie on your way out. They'll be hanging out by the tent. They've got a gift for you. Let's go ahead and pray, and we'll be dismissed. Father, we come to you. We thank you for your many blessings. We thank you that you are who you are. And God, even when you saw us and you saw who we were, you still loved us and you still wanted us. And God, we thank you for that. Thank you for the great message that we heard today. Help us to take what we've learned and apply it in our lives as we go out and bless others. We pray in your son Jesus' name. Amen.